Hi, Anne. Hi, Lisa. I'm going to make you a co-host, Lisa. Up bright and early.
Oh, well, yeah, it's 11 o'clock there. So looks like I need to get my camera working. I don't see my face there.
No, don't see your face yet. All maybe right. It's connecting.
There we there go. There I am. Seems like every time I get on, Zoom does different things with me. So
doesn't it? I'm going to let our other speaker in so I can make her a.
Hi, Lisa.
Hi. Nice to see you. Trying to scoot over my computer a little bit so I don't see my window. There we go. And my grandson's playroom is the place where I have kind of a blank wall behind me.
Bonjour, Marie-José.
Bonjour, vous allez bien?
Ça va bien, ça va bien. Et vous?
Oui, ça va très bien, merci.
Oui. I've made both you and Lisa co-hosts so that when it's your turn to speak, you can share your screens.
So who will?
There, Lindsay? Okay. I'm going to let Lindsay in so she can help me check who we admit. We haven't been bombed.
So. I know. That's a good thing. That's a good thing.
Yep. We had an Honor Society meeting way back early on in June, and it got bombed.
Yes, it was terrible. Gosh. I was in the meeting, and poor Regina had to quit them. Fortunately, it was at the end of the meeting, so it didn't affect a lot of what happened, but it was terrible. Yeah.
Aww. Yeah.
Now, have you done that? Have you made me a
Yes, co-host? I have. Yep, right. You're a co-host.
Okay, I'm just looking.
You should be able to share your screen now.
My screen, all right. That's what I'm trying to find here.
So, Jake, is it in French or in English?
In English.
Not the presentation.
Oui, mais vous pouvez faire en français.
Oui, ok.
Oui, oui,
oui. Oui, oui, absolument.
Non, je peux parler en anglais, mais mon français est beaucoup meilleur.
Non, les gens apprécient aussi si c'est en français. Hier, on était tout en français. Oui. Pour la première fois, c'est la première fois de toute la série. Okay. Et ça, c'est. Les gens sont restés jusqu'à la fin pour écouter.
Je pense que demain aussi, tout le monde va parler en français.
OK. Parce
que moi, je vais parler en français. Tracy va le faire en français.
Et Angèle.
Angèle va parler en français, je pense aussi. Oui.
OK. Yeah, most of them have been in. Most of the presentations have been in English.
But. Okay, good. I wanted to make sure I hadn't missed. I could have done it in French, but right now it'd be a little hard to switch over.
Yeah, to switch. No,
it's fine. It's fine.
Whatever you feel comfortable with, and sometimes when you're talking about technical, pedagogical stuff, it's hard to do it in French.
Right now,
certainly tech stuff. Even if you know the terminology, a lot of your listeners don't. So.
Yeah. Exactly. Right. Exactly.
So do you still see me because I'm?
Yes, we still see you.
All right, I'm just trying to
share your screen here.
Right.
Lisa would talk first and I would talk after, correct?
Or I'm sorry?
Keep up,
Alex. Yeah, Lisa's going to go first.
Okay, yeah.
And then your second half. Let's see, still can't figure out the sharing?
No. I've always started my own, so I'm just.
Oh, I see.
At the bottom of your.
The share screen, the green share screen button at the bottom.
I never see. Yeah, right. That is what I've done, but for some reason. All right, hold on, maybe.
So you're definitely a co-host.
Right. I just see my choices are pause, stop, mute my audio, stop video, rename, pin video, spotlight, hide self view. Okay, here we go. Thanks for your patience.
That's why we're here early. Voila, you're there.
But you can't see my screen yet, can you?
Yes, we see your screen.
Oh, you do? Well, yeah. You darn.
Yep, see your PowerPoint.
Okay, great. Well, let's see if I can move everything around so I can get it on present mode here. There we go. All right, so that looks like the whole thing. Okay, yep. Good. Gotcha, wonderful.
We had 300 people this morning total.
Oh my God.
So I don't know. We've been averaging maybe about 60%.
Uh-huh. It's hard. People sign up, they want it. Yeah, they want to do it all, and then sometimes life gets in the way.
I'm sure.
Exactly. Exactly.
Wow. 300, it's a lot.
That was, yes. I think we have, yesterday we had over 600, like 660 something, I think, registered. But I think we just had about 320 show up. So
yeah,
still a lot, yeah. But it's not hardly even half of the people who registered. And tomorrow there are 700 pre-registered. But
wow!
Oh my God, I didn't realize.
That's incredible. You know, it's incredible. And this one would probably, if it had been announced at the very first, would have had that many as well, because they've kind of been growing.
Yeah, people have been hearing about them. And then I shared a link actually yesterday for this presentation today with one of my colleagues that I had coffee with. So, yeah, I mean, it's something we need to consider doing mm-hmm. next year also. Even if we have our conference, we should probably do an online, something online also for people who can't make it to the conference. I'm thinking this is something we'll have to do in the future.
Yep, something I've wanted to do for a long time, but it just never. It just never took off to have someone step up and organize it.
Yeah.
So. Oh, I can't imagine the undertaking. I really can't.
It is. I mean, fortunately here we had our speakers. So we emailed the speakers from the convention and took the volunteers who responded. We had quite several exhibitors. And so we had two sessions that were just exhibitors. And then other people volunteered and they seemed to kind of fall in nice groups thematically.
Good.
And then Jane put together a temporary program and we looked at it together and she grouped them very nicely. I think it was really, it's been really good. So
yeah. I wish I would have been able to catch more of them than I have. We kind of had a lot going on, nothing very exciting, but we have two grandchildren that live 2 miles away. One is a 1-month-old baby, so we're spending a lot of time there, but also taking her 3-year-old brother off of the parents' hands as much as we can. I love it when my daughter says, Mom, it's really hard having two. Of course, she has a younger brother, and I just try to act real surprised.
Lisa, where are you located?
I live in Columbus, Ohio.
Oh, in Ohio. Okay.
Yep.
I'm in California. So it's bright and early for me.
Oh, it is early for you.
Yeah. And yesterday we were celebrating Bastille Day. It turns out it's my son's birthday.
Oh my gosh, a French teacher that managed to have a son. Oh my gosh, I can't.
Bastille Day, yeah. And I said till he was about, and of course, my husband's an only child, so we would go to France every summer to spend so that his parents could see the kids. And we were always there in July, of course, until my son was about 6, he always thought the fireworks were for his birthday.
Well, and my daughter's birthday is the 4th of July, so we had the same thing.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Oh, I just let 58 people in. I didn't realize I was supposed to be letting people in.
Okay. Yeah, we need to check who we're letting in.
Oh, I do need to check? So I wasn't supposed to touch it?
Yeah, no, we were letting...
Oh, sorry.
We're quite ready to start yet, although...
Sorry. Is there anything I can do? Okay.
Yeah, no, we'll take care of letting people in.
Okay, good. That's what I originally thought, and then I saw so many people, and then I got nervous.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, I was just kind of waiting closer to the time.
That makes sense. I'll keep my hands off of everything. Sorry about that.
here's someone with a phone number.
Oh, gosh. All right, sorry. Is there anything I can do? Can I undo it? Can I do anything?
No, that's okay. It's 2 minutes still, so that's not a big deal.
All right.
And I've kind of been treating it like popcorn. As people are still popping in the waiting room, we keep letting them in, and then it slows down and we'll start.
Okay.
Already got 82. So, see that. Yeah, if you have lots of participants, I'd say if you have more than the 100 basic participants, you one or two people who are just monitoring.
Oh, I'm sure.
Letting people in, and if you're restricting it. The thing we had, the problem when we... Hi, who is that?
This is Mary Mba. I'm calling from Nevada. I mean, I wanted to let you know our network is down.
Okay, so you're using your phone.
I can't... Yeah, I'm on my phone, so I'm not going to be able to take any pictures to send to...
Okay,
to send
got it.
To prove my part, yeah, today. Thank you.
All right.
Can you mute me back?
Yes, I'll find it. We'll mute everyone when we start, so. Hello, everyone. I've been enjoying all the Zoom guests on the TV shows who have barking dogs in the background.
We have four, but they're in the basement in their crates, and I have the headphones, so I think you'll be safe. The nice thing is that it's cooler. Our house is 100 years old, so the air conditioning is about, well, the furnace is 50 years old, so it gets kind of warm upstairs here.
All right, let's see.
Okay, do you plug it in?
Oh, here you are, Lindsay. You keep bouncing around in here, so. Okay. No. All right. It is. We still have people coming into the waiting room, so we'll keep going. Okay, well, bonjour tout le monde. Je crois que on va commencer. Les gens continuent à arriver. Thank you so much for being with us today. We have two speakers, and so each of them will speak for approximately 55 to 60 minutes. If we have any time left, we will have time for questions, but you can also pose your questions in the chat box, and we will share that with the presenters and share the answers along with the video. If you want a certificate of participation, you can take a screenshot or a picture of your screen, email it to us at staff@frenchteachers.org, and we will send you a certificate of participation for attending the webinar. So without further ado, I will pass the screen and the mic to our first speaker, Lisa Shepherd.
Great. Hello, everybody. Thanks for coming. And just, I want to double check everybody can see my screen, because for some reason I'm not seeing my screen, but you can, right?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Well, it's great to see you here today. I'm Lisa Shepherd, and after 29 years, I taught French for 29 years at the high school level, a little bit at the college and preschool, elementary school for a while. For the last couple years, I've been out of the classroom and am doing some consulting. and other fun stuff. So if you need to reach me, if you have any questions after today, this is my contact information. So the title, I'll go back real quick. The title of our presentation today is Using Authentic Text as a Springboard for Interpersonal Communication. So we have objectives for today. So after this webinar, I hope that we'll each be able to select appropriate text, authentic text, based on the proficiency level of your students, design a variety of interpersonal tasks, which incorporate the language and culture of the authentic resources, and then to assess the students in the interpersonal mode. A few minutes on that. So we start with selecting the authentic text based on the proficiency level of the students. And we have really been working on that for the past several years now, haven't we? And it's gotten a lot easier since the internet. Some of us that were teaching before the internet, and people almost can't understand what that was like, but thank goodness for the internet. So we're kind of a reason that we do this is if we look at the ACFL core practices, designing, I want to start with this one. Sorry about that. So we start by that the students will be doing something to interpret an authentic resource, and then we'll use that as a springboard to the interpersonal task. So just kind of as a reminder, what kind of the ACFL definition of an authentic resource is, it's a resource created by a member of the target culture for other members of the target culture. Now, a lot of us use other resources too, and that's awesome. For this particular presentation, we're going to be talking about those authentic resources. So there are lots of reasons why we want to do that. I'll let you read. I'll just spend a little tiny bit. But this prepares our students for what we really want to prepare them for, right? For using the language in real life outside of our classroom. So I find that when I only used textbook resources, for example, then my students only learned how to read something or listen to something when they knew all the words. But once I incorporate some of those authentic resources, the students start to develop those skills and that confidence to go outside of using just their memorized vocab that we chose, and to learn how to use their skills to kind of attack something, even if they don't know what all the words are. Also, these authentic resources give us that, have that culture embedded. So we don't have to decide, oh, my students need to know this about a target culture. When we're using authentic resources, like if you're doing a unit on sports, if you're showing an infographic about what sports are the most popular in a Francophone country, we don't have to then have a separate lesson on sports in the Francophone country. It's just all embedded. So as we interpret that text and then speak about that text, we're incorporating that. Culture is embedded, it's not separate. And then we also just make sure that our language is really updated. I found once I started using some authentic resources that some of the words I had learned in a textbook back in the 80s, you know, weren't always the best word to use anymore. So having those authentic resources helps, it ensures that our students are using current vocabulary. So kind of when we talk, we're going to talk a little bit, as I'm talking about resources and activities, I'm going to be using the proficiency descriptors. So just kind of a reminder that our level one students, we're targeting about novice mid, level two novice high, level three intermediate low, level four intermediate mid, level five intermediate high. And of course, there's a wide variety in our students, isn't there? So I'm going to go through these examples real quick because I know that most of us are already using authentic resources. But for novices, we really need phrases and pictures at the beginning. They're really reading the pictures. Then discrete sentences, meaning they're not connected in any way. There's just one sentence at a time with a picture. And then by that, novice high, strings of sentences. So because of that, the need for having those pictures to read, infographics are super important with our novice learners. There's a lot of culture in there. We can talk about them to provide more input to our students. And even sometimes I find myself using some infographics with intermediate students as just kind of a context for a conversation. So some examples, because I do have a lot of people that I work with are concerned, like my French 1 students, what can they really read? What can they understand? Well, they can read this, right? They can read an infographic with a genre of a movie with some picture support. We won't say what's under that black rectangle. some kind of movies you don't probably want to talk about in class. So then, of course, some infographics are more detailed. This one's, of course, real blurry, but just this might be a type of infographic that you would use with an intermediate student. Social media is great because there's a couple of things I really like about it. It's very searchable. Usually we can use hashtags and quotation marks to get something very specific that we want. Also, so that can be for target vocabulary or structures. Also, once the students really, it's so current, it's so right there. And I know this was the first Twitter activity that I did with my students. And really, I just wanted some authentic examples of the expression Saturday. So I just went on Twitter, quotation, Saturday, end quote. And then I had immediately all these quotes or all these tweets where people were inviting their friends to do something on Twitter. So good or bad, it was not 5 minutes after I passed this out that the students were phones under the desk tweeting these people and getting tweets back. So I think social media is really powerful as an authentic resource because it encourages the students to interact. These were some Instagram posts that I did real quick. Again, because there's so many pictures, that gives really good support. Children's magazine, this of course was originally in color, but an example of something that would have lots of pictures with just a few words. This was from Astrapi, I think. Online articles, emergent readers, other kind of fun stuff you find. This was a pen pal site. This was a site for an au pair that I used with a family unit because it had all those great kind of vocabulary instructors that we might talk about in a family unit with adjectives describing people. This was from a home exchange site. So, and then of course, we're texts, authentic resources are not just print texts, but they're also videos. So we love cartoons. My students love Toto especially, and I find Toto videos are awesome for those novice mid by then to start watching those. Educational songs. So in intermediate texts, we get more into connected sentences and paragraph lengths. So some things they might understand are memes, quotes, we use those a lot. Advertisements, I think, are really great for encouraging critical thinking because you can look at those and decide why are they wanting to, why does the company that made this want you to, why do they think, why does Bennett think you should buy their bread? Okay, we have this great picture of hands and we have this word, you know, this is his name, these hands made your bread. But of course, we can talk a little bit about that. Is Bennett one guy getting up at 4 a.m. to make your bread? You know, it's more of a chain bakery. Blogs are great. Whoops. This is an online encyclopedia I use a lot when I'm looking for some information. Vlogs, oh, looks like that one doesn't work anymore. Music videos, commercials, animated shorts. A lot of times the animated shorts don't have words, but we can narrate them to create the language. Movie trailers. So a lot of times people ask me about what is the best way to find all of these resources. So of course, AATF, we have all these great resources, a lot that Catherine has prepared for us. I follow a lot of other of French teachers on Pinterest. That way, when they pick something they really love, then I can get it. It will appear on my feed. Sometimes I read blogs of teachers in a Francophone country and look what they create for their students, and something that a first grade teacher prepares might be really good for my beginning learners. A lot of times for novices, I say to use Google Images instead of just Google, because that way you'll get what you need, a text with lots of pictures. I add Expliquer aux enfants to my search engine a lot of times when I want to find something that's a little simpler. I always try to subscribe to one children's magazine at a time. I really like Astrapi for beginners, Okapi, Phosphor, some of those. And on YouTube, I always use, there's a, you can change it to that finding just videos that are 4 minutes or less. So I like to use those shorter ones. And these are just a few things that some of the resources I really like. So after we've chosen that resource, the beginning of our process here is then have the students interpret it some way. So today is about interpersonal communication and not interpretive. So I'm not going to talk a little bit about that, but you know, there's a lot of different interpretive tasks that I use. I think right now graphic organizers are excellent. For one thing, because a lot of us will be teaching distance for a while, a graphic organizer is something that the responses are so individual that there is less of an opportunity that the students are working together, collaborating outside of class, of your time together. You would know right away if someone's just handing in someone else's work, because no two people would have the exact same answers on a graphic organizer. And of course, there's technology to help us with those interpretive tasks too, like FluentKey, at Puzzle. All right, so that prepares us for what our actual topic for today is, just a background, is now that you've chosen your authentic resource and you've created an interpretive task for it, now we're using, what can we do with it now? You've gone to all that trouble, right, to find the perfect resource, so we want to keep using it, and we want to use that as a reason for our students to speak. So this is the interpersonal communication task. So it's just kind of a reminder, because I find of all the communicative modes that the most kind of misunderstanding, I think, is about interpersonal. So it requires this active communication or active negotiation of meaning. So if it's something that they can memorize or a skit that they memorize, that wouldn't count as interpersonal. So we're really, you're going to see in these activities that we look at that each of these tasks will be something they couldn't prepare ahead of time, that they're going to be negotiating at whatever level, language level they're at, they're going to be negotiating to get this work done. And these ones that we look at today are going to be oral interpersonal tasks. I think it's really hard to ensure a negotiation of meaning with a written interpersonal task, because generally, whatever the situation is, they're going to have some time with resources or some time to kind of perfect that. So as kind of a reminder, our novice students, this is the benchmark. So I can communicate in spontaneous, I think that word spontaneous is so important, spoken, written, or signed conversations on both very familiar and everyday topics, using a variety of practice or memorized words, phrases, simple sentences, and questions. So I'm not going to read these, but it's kind of a reminder, if you're less familiar with the can-do statements, for each of those benchmarks, they're going to be divided into low, mid, and high, and they're also going to be three different functions for each one. So there's always a function about exchanging information and ideas, but then still at the same level, instead there's meet my needs or address situations, and then expressing, reacting to, and supporting preferences and opinions. So I hope as we look at the task in a couple minutes here, that you'll see that we've focused on different functions. They're not all describing, they're not all expressing opinions. So the intermediate benchmark moves to familiar topics, creating sentences and series of sentences, and asking and answering questions. And then for advanced, some of us here will have advanced students, and then we add time frames, unfamiliar topics, connected sentences, and probing questions. Okay, so these are some of the things that I like to do to encourage interpersonal communication in my class. Most of the things we'll look at, we'll have two students talking to each other, but in this case, this would just be a whole class activity where you could have a photo of some sort and ask lots of questions to the students. So that would be interpersonal communication as they were answering those. This would be something I would do maybe really quick at the end, at the beginning of a class, as kind of a hook to set the stage for the lesson. This activity I use a lot. I use this sometimes. This was an art unit, but I've done it for other types of pictures. But the students have to discuss to see what's missing. So to prepare that, I just use some kind of comic book picture and use my little whiteout marker and white some things out and kind of draw them in. So that's a great interpersonal task. Now this, like I said, was an art unit, done it for Halloween where there was a Halloween picture and I whited out a mask or a tree or whatever it is. Another interpersonal task I like to use with the students, with novices, is a picture comparison. So one student would have, that partner A would have this picture. In this case, it was obviously a house unit with some bedroom pictures. And their partner would have this picture. And then they would just fill out this. They could fill out a Venn diagram. I don't like writing in circles, so I usually draw my Venn diagrams like this. But the student, they have to ask each other a question before they can fill it out. So, you know, I ask my part, if I'm partner A, and then I say, tu as un lit. And so then if my partner answers, yes, j'ai un lit, whoops, I need to stop touching things. So then under les deux chambres, un lit, or nous avons un lit, depending on what your expectations are for your students. And that's very easy to prepare. It takes very little time to prepare that, just grabbing two pictures. And then as a follow-up, I try to, a lot of these activities, I'm just going to make a few suggestions of what you might do afterwards to get more and more mileage out of your authentic resource. So a presentational task might be to describe one of the rooms and tell why you like it better. So sometimes the resource itself can lead to kind of just some interview questions. So in this case, we had this infographic about breakfast in Belgium, and then just some very, some questions already written out you would ask your partner and circle their response. Again, these are low novices where we don't expect them to be able to formulate questions yet. So I either give them the question stem that they would use or just write out the question. This matching game, my students love, love, love. So this, there would be a lot more pictures in this, but this is just to make it able to see something you can see on the screen. But partner A has a group of pictures. I usually have 16 or 20. And then partner B also has the same pictures, but they're in a different order. So this is really working on that describing function where they would take turns describing a picture. So if I'm a novice French student, you know, maybe I say, Elise. So then my partner looks and maybe they're really struggling with il and elle, those early beginners. So they, maybe they would say deux personnes, une personne. And then when you say deux personnes, then they would say F and you would say that's numéro un. And then the partner A would put an F next to their one and the partner B would put a one next to their F and they would have made the matching. My students asked to play this, I guess because I call it a game, but there's really great negotiation even at that novice level. This was just an example of the same activity, but this was with a cartoon, Petit Ours Brun. So it's also can be a way to review a narrative, a cartoon video. A similar activity, it looks the same at first, but in this, instead of matching pictures, they are conversing to decide whether or not their pictures are the same or different. So if they'll start with number one, il y a un garçon, il met une bouteille dans le bac à recyclage, and then, you know, it's the same or different. You can ask a follow-up question again. So it's just same or different. And it's the same with the cartoon videos, the cartoon screenshots. Another one that's really popular with my students is this guess who game. So this part on the left isn't part of the game, but this is just, I give the students the pictures that they're gonna see and I want to make sure they understand what the language is for that picture. So, je fais le linge, je fais la cuisine, je fais les courses, je fais la vaisselle, je fais le bric. Il fait le bricolage, sorry about that. Il fait du jardinage. And then, so that's so they know what the picture represents. And then for the actual activity, each student will pick an identity of one of the people. Let's say I'm Amina. Then my partner is going to ask questions to figure out who I am. So my partner is going to say, tu fais le linge? And then I answer, oui, je fais le linge. Tu fais la cuisine? Oui, je fais la cuisine. Tu fais le jardinage? Oui, je fais le jardinage. Tu fais la vaisselle? Oui, je fais la vaisselle. So then they would know that I was Amina. Of course, not everyone has them. And this also, I would have several, at least a dozen different identities, and they would have more pictures. But in each case, there's only one identity that has the exact same task. This one obviously was for a lesson we were talking about chores. So another activity I would do a lot in class is speed friending. I especially love this for the students to practice with asking questions. So to make it really to have enough negotiation, I would give the students lots of possible questions. So in this case, the text that we used with this was this video about autumn, and I also had a reading they did about autumn. And then based on the vocabulary from the reading and the video, I made all the long list of questions that they might ask someone about what they do in the fall. And to kind of give more of a context to make it a more authentic task, I said, vos parents partent en voyage pendant notre long weekend en octobre et vous demandent de choisir un camarade avec qui passer le weekend. Donc, vous allez poser les mêmes questions à cinq personnes pour savoir l'élève avec qui vous voulez passer le weekend. So just to give a context about why they would be asking someone all these questions, I want to make sure you choose somebody to spend the October break with that does fun stuff you like to do. So the students would pick any five courses. I think there were space maybe for seven questions, but they would pick any of those questions that they want. If they all just ask the same question, then we would lose some of that negotiation because they would know the question before they heard it. So the students pick any seven that are most important to them. And then they ask, I would have them in two rows facing each other. They would ask that person in 1 minute or 2 minutes. I would say, okay, move one to the right, one seat to the right, but only one row moves. The first time they both moved and then they still have the same partner. So only one person moves. Or one side moves, and then they ask those same questions. So this is a great way for them to really get to be able to start asking questions because I've given them, but they're saying them over and over again. And then as a follow-up, they can write a note explaining which classmate they want to spend the weekend with and why. So, you know, je veux passer le weekend avec Janine, elle aussi, elle aime sauter dans les feuilles, elle n'aime pas jouer au foot et moi non plus, or something like that. Another activity, this one I call a partner top hat because the diagram is a top hat. It can be also with a Venn diagram. So this starts with an authentic resource like this where you can see that this would be something where a French child would write or a French speaking child would write what time they do something. So when we worked with that, after we work with that a bit, I have phrases here that I took from that resource, and the students start in A by checking the sentence that was true for them. So, je me réveille avant 6 heures, je me lève tout de suite, je prends mon petit déjeuner à la maison, je m'habille avant le petit déjeuner. And they'll check just those sentences that are true for them. So the next part then is that they will compare their daily routine to that of their partner. So they would ask questions, and in this case, there really were only a few verbs. I gave them the sentence starter, the stem for the question, and they had to listen kind of with the picture activity we look like and then compare their routine. So I say to my partner, tu te réveilles avant 6 heures? And if she responds, oui, je me réveille avant 6 heures. Then at the bottom, I write, nous nous réveillons avant 6 heures. If she answers no, je me réveille après 6 heures, then my sentence is, under the moi column, je me réveille avant 6 heures. Now, if she asks me, tu te lèves tout de suite, but I don't get up right away, I hit the snooze alarm, so then I say non, je ne me lève pas tout de suite. And in that case, she writes, moi, je me réveille tout de suite. And I write, ma partenaire, elle se lève tout de suite. So in, after each question answer, there will be a sentence, but you won't know where your sentence is till you hear from your partner. So either you do it, only she does it, or you both do it. And one follow-up task might be to give some suggestions on how your partner can have a little better morning routine. Another really simple activity that wouldn't take that doesn't take very long to prepare. I mean, any kind of information gap, right? In this case, I took this, gave each student the same infographic, and I just put a little clear text box over some of the information. So this obviously was just the amounts of time that students in those grades would have for each subject matter, and then they would just ask the questions to find out the information that's missing, whatever's been whited out on their paper. So then chat stations. For this one, usually the students, I would have these pictures spread all over the room, taped to the walls, just great to, for the students to get to move around a little bit. And they would start, so they would, each group of four or so would be at a different picture. And I just kind of, they would talk about those pictures, but start them off. I just gave them some questions that they might want to discuss. You can see the questions I had there. So then after 5 minutes or whatever the time was, then I would have them move to the next picture in the room until that each group had been to each picture. Then some kind of role play I'd like to have, especially if for something when it got to a summative assessment at the end of the unit. So I would just give a little bit of a situation in which somebody might be talking about the text and assign roles to the students. So these obviously were adoptable cats. One person's about to go pick out a cat. They're showing their picture to their friend and they'll give, they'll talk about which cat they should get. So another activity that I like, because I love finding authentic resources so much, and I love spending all my time on Pinterest, and I usually end up with too many authentic texts. I have more authentic texts than I can even have my students read. So this one works great when I have too many because I get to use two of them. So one partner has the one on the left, and the other one has the one on the right. And then you'll see they have questions. But of course the questions, the answer is not found on their own infographic because then it wouldn't be an interpersonal task. So the questions are found on the partner's infographic. So, quelle proportion de foyers possède un animal? So then my partner reads there and tells me. So, un sur deux, une moitié, 50%. So that can focus really on the content of the information, but I'm giving them the questions. And when we get to the intermediate task, we'll see that by the time they're in intermediates, my expectation is they can write the question. So I do it a little bit differently. Another one that's activity that's popular is get one, get one, give one, get one. So the students each, they could have the same text and write down their top five main ideas, or they could have different texts about the same topic. So they're going to read their text and write down 5 or 10 main ideas. And then they move around the room and they share their idea. They share their main idea and then their partner writes down their main idea and then gives her main idea. So and that's pretty simple because it's not exactly questions. So they can do this at pretty much, you know, novice mid-level. So those are some ideas about novice activities. So next, we're going to look at some intermediate tasks that we might use. So this is another one that my students really love. So this is a crossword puzzle. And you can see, though, there's no clues. So these are words that would have been important in a text that we have read or a video that they have watched. And each one partner A, has all the vertical responses filled in, and partner B has all the horizontal responses filled in. So their job is to use circumlocution to give clues to their partner so their partner can write down the word. Of course, they cannot say the word, right? But they do... use circumlocution to do it. So it's a really great way to review the content of whatever text it was that they read or listened to, because they're using that same content to give clues. And I do use this one even with novices with very concrete vocabulary, like months of the year. You know, if you teach them the words before and after, you know, le mois après janvier, le mois avant décembre. So if you had this filled out with different months, your students can figure it out. Numbers, with numbers, it looks great. It works great for novices. I was going to say something else about that. What I really like about this one too is that it's self-correcting. The students pretty much know if they guessed right because it's the answer that will fit in the blank. So I like that. That gives them some confidence. So this, like I said, is another version of the interpretive interview that we looked at before with the pets, but this is the intermediate example. And in this case, you'll see that the questions are not even exactly questions, it's more just a detail that's asked for, but it's just a clue in English. So the students then have to formulate the question that would give them that information. So the average age of becoming a grandfather. So à quel âge est-ce qu'on devient un grand-père? Something by the intermediate level, we expect them to be able to figure out the question. And of course, it might not be perfect, but that's okay, because that's where you're going to have that great negotiation of meaning, because their partner, you know, will ask some kind of follow-up question to make sure they understand. This is quite similar. In this case, they're comparing two different texts. So each student would jot down the main facts from their infographic. And then they discuss with a partner to complete a Venn diagram or one of those other organizers, comparison organizers, to compare the information from their infographics. So it's a great way to bring in two infographics, but you just make sure there's enough that the two have in common. So in this case, there were several details in common. This interactive word wall, I had really great success with. So this was a unit on the environment, and I used manipulative. As you can see, the students working at the desk. So I just had all kinds of vocabulary that had been in our text that we had read about the environment, and the students worked in groups of four. And then besides the cards that had the vocabulary word, there are cards with arrows. So the first student takes two cards, connects them with an arrow, explaining what the relationship is between those two words. And in doing so, they're reviewing that content. And it's really critical thinking to connect the words. So, si on achète en vrac, il n'y aurait pas d'emballage. So then they've connected those two words, en vrac and les emballages, with an arrow. And then the next person would have to pick a word and connect it to one of those. So at the end, that desk will have all of the vocabulary words connected to the other words, but each group of four will have a totally different web, a totally different wall, because they will have seen different connections. And then you can follow up by having students discuss their connections and as you circulate around the room. I was real nervous about this. I saw this in a workshop and I thought, I don't know how to pick the words that will be all connected to each other. But in fact, I just picked random words and the students did find a way to connect them all. So this is similar. So you pick some kind of text and the students write down their top three most important ideas. Everybody does that individually, so that's a good interpretive task. But then they get with a partner and they have to come up with a common set of the top three. So there's a lot of that function of expressing opinions and doing some convincing of why that the ideas you chose are more important than the ones your partner chose. This one also was new to me a couple years ago, and I really love the critical thinking aspect of it. And for the interpretive tasks at the beginning, you assign students a color of hat. So these are called the critical thinking hats. And there are actually six, and I just use these five. But the last one, it was, I think, kind of linguistically difficult for my students. So based on the color of hat they've been assigned, they'll take a certain type, they'll jot down a certain type of information. So if they're assigned the white hat, and I just divide them into groups, you're the white hat, you're the red hat. If you're totally awesomer than me, then you could actually make little hats and assign those to the, put those on the student's desk, but I never had time for that. So you're the white hat. So the person with the white hat is just writing down facts from the article about the topic that you're studying. The red hat stands for emotions. So that person is going to be writing down either emotions that were expressed in the article, like in an interview in the article, or even their own emotions reading about this. The gray hat is more of judgment. So a little bit more negative, kind of like that cloud, like a gray cloud. So they'll pick up some kind of judgy things from the article or express their own judgment or more negative emotion about something in the article. The yellow hat is about a real positive view, so something really optimistic, an optimistic point of view. And then the green hat is creativity, so you're asking questions or making some statements to provoke. So that's the interpretive part that happens first, but after everyone has done that, then you assign a discussion to the students, and there's really nothing that you have to prepare because the students are prepared for the discussion based on the color of hat that they're wearing. So they'll get to use their ideas that they jotted down when they were reading. But it creates a really quite sophisticated conversation when people, when each student is wearing a different hat, they have different things to say. So another role play, this would just be an example, a little bit more sophisticated than the novice one that we looked at. This was an article about girls going to school. So you can see that I've assigned these two roles. One for the person who works at UNICEF and is building a school, and they're visiting the families to encourage them to enroll their daughters in school, their teen daughter in school. And then the other partner is the parent of a family in Guinea explaining why you can't enroll your daughter. So based on this infographic, they would have known a lot of reasons. This infographic and other ones that we read in that unit would know some of the reasons that families would have trouble enrolling their children in school, especially daughters. Philosophical chairs. When I use this one, I used it after we had read Le Petit Prince. So the teacher makes a statement, and I did it at the very end of the unit. My statement was, Le Petit Prince est mort à la fin. So the students that did believe that he died at the end of the story, it sounds very concrete, but I think really we all have a lot of ideas about that. And I've read like on the Facebook page, people who had an absolutely different takeaway. So I'm sure each one of you that have read the book have your own takeaway about whether or not that sentence is true, as did my students. So they said on one side of the room, there are two rows or two groups facing each other. On one side of the room, if you feel that he died at the end, and the other side of the room, if you don't feel like he died at the end. So then as the teacher, I moderate the discussion by asking someone on each side. So you know, Tiffin, you think he died at the end? Why do you think he died at the end? She, well, he got bit by a snake. So then, you know, you go to the other side of the room. Why don't you think he died? He got bit by a poisonous snake. Yeah, but the pilot didn't find his body. So then you move back. And you're kind of encouraging the students as they hear new information to move the sides of the room that they're on. I was hesitant with this one because it seemed so open-ended and I didn't know if my students would be able to handle it. And we had a really, really great conversation and really great critical thinking. One student added, well, he didn't die because he was never alive. He was a figment of the pilot's imagination. Well, that's pretty, that works. You know, I like that. Let's argue that. So it really is a conversation that could last for a really long time. And it really got the students interested. This one is kind of like, it's set up like a basketball bracket. So I pick a state or a question based on our unit of study. So, pourquoi faut-il assurer l'éducation pour tous? And then with a partner, a small group, they're gonna debate two ideas at a time. So starting with the first match is la mortalité infantile and la santé maternelle. So which of those would be the most important reason that everybody needs to go to school? And together they would decide which of those was more important and write that in the blank box in the second column. Then they would discuss the next two, and the next two. Then, so they narrowed the eight down to four, and then they would discuss those to narrow it down to two, and at the end would end up with one, the overarching reason why education for all is so important. And of course, each group would have a different reason at the end. Cornell note-taking is an interpretive task. So the students read a text, whatever it is, and in the big box over here, they fill in, they just take some notes. That's up to them. That's not even something I look at. Then as they're reading, they're also asking some questions, and they can be very literal level questions that are answered directly in the text, or they could be a question that comes to them as they're reading, something that they would like to look into or discuss further. And then at the bottom, they write a summary. So that's an interpretive task too. But after I have them do that, maybe for 45 minutes or something, then less, however long the text is, then I give them some time to discuss. And you know, the beauty of this one is I didn't have to write anything down. So the students have already written all their discussion questions right here. So then I just give them 15 minutes or 20 minutes to discuss in their own small group the questions that they've written down. So this is a great activity when you maybe didn't have time to prepare much for that class. It's still a great activity. So barometer, this I think a lot of people use. It's just the students line up in order. So I actually use this even with novice students. I have them line up according to your birthday. So whoever's birthday is closest to January 1st is at the beginning of the line. Whoever's birthday is closest to December 31st is at the end of the line. So, you know, even novices can say, when's your birthday? And they still have to listen. They might have to have their student repeat, their partner repeat, in order to place themselves in the line. And then as a follow-up, the teacher can have each student say their birthday, and you can make sure everybody's in the right order. It gives a great chance to provide some input if some students are not in the right order. Later on, for the intermediate students, you could ask, you know, a little tougher question. So the one I wrote preparing this, no students should be in school this fall. So the students will discuss that with each other in order to place them in line with how strongly they feel. The person who most agrees with that statement in the front of the line and the person who least agrees in the back of the line. So you really have to, as you join the line, have to really discuss it. You know, maybe say, well, yes, most students shouldn't be in school in the fall, but maybe students who live in a state that has no COVID at all, maybe they could be safely in school. And somebody else might feel, maybe if everyone wears masks and we have the windows open or whatever, but you have some great conversations as they put themselves in the correct place in the line. Four corners is similar, right? But you make a statement and they go to a corner based on how much they agree. So you could use that same question as an example. And then they talk to each other. You have them talk to each other in the corner about why they chose that answer. You have some students report back about why they chose that answer. 20-word summary, again, is a little bit of a negotiation. So you take a text and the student, for that first box, they write exactly 20 words summarizing the text. Then they get with a partner and they write a new summary in number two, where they incorporate the ideas of both people. And then in three, they even make a larger group and write a new one. Socratic seminars, there's lots of information here, but I want to make sure that we have time to finish up and then have a couple questions. So you can read over that, but there's lots of great research out there or great ideas about Socratic seminars. So then a little bit about assessment, because that's something that comes up a lot when I'm working with teachers. Most of these activities that I looked at will be formative activities that your students will just be doing in class as part of your lesson. So how I assess the students is I always circulate among them. I know people say, well, how do you make sure your students are speaking French the whole time? Because I'm walking around. You, of course, don't want to be sitting at your desk while the students are working on these. You're walking around. I always try to have a clipboard with me. Even if your clipboard doesn't have anything on it, if you just walk around with a clipboard, the students know that you're paying attention. And they want you to be proud of them. So walk around. I try to take little notes. I usually have a roster and I just put like a little E if I hear someone speak in English, or OT because they're off task. So I just have a little data about how the students are doing with the task. And also giving them feedback as I'm walking around, responding to what they're saying. Great feedback is always responding on the content, not correcting every little bit of error unless it affects comprehension. And then also, I do have a little rubric I use. When I share this out later, you can check that. But it's just a formative rubric that gives the students a little bit of feedback. For summative, because I always at the end of every unit would give an integrated performance assessment, and I would use one of those tasks like a role play as their summative assessment. Now, in this case, I want to make sure that I can hear everybody. For their whole entire dialogue to give more specific feedback. So I do give the students a prompt ahead of time. You're going to be someone who's adopting a cat. Your partner's going to look at pictures with you, and you, the two of you are going to talk about which cat would be better. So they wouldn't have the actual pictures ahead of time, the text, but they would have, they would know what they were going to do. And then I would call two students up at a time. So since my interpersonal task comes during part of it, of a 9 PA, the rest of the class might be working on the written task. So they're all busy, and I pull up two students who don't know they're going to be partners with each other and have them do the task. So I think it's really important that they don't know who their partner will be, because we don't want anyone memorizing an exact dialogue. So if they're novices, they might memorize the questions, and that's okay, because we don't expect them to really create questions on their own yet. So, but even if they do memorize a question, they still, we'll be negotiating meaning, because if they say, oh, I like this, you know, gray cat the best. Oh, yes, it says he's friendly. So there still is going to be that spontaneous conversation. All right, so that brings me up to question time. I think I'm going to unshare. If you'll give me patience. Stop share. Here we go. Okay, so, oh my gosh, chat 96. Okay, I'm gonna try. That kind of directions was to look at this. Oh, all right, so some of it's privately.
Well, Lisa, I think the question that most people are asking in there on all of your activities is if you have any ideas for doing some of these things remotely.
Right. So obviously that's a challenge. But what from people that I have talked to is I think a lot of people are scheduling Google Meets or Zooms and scheduling with just two or a small group of students at a time. Each of these assessments would only take 2 to 3 minutes, maybe 1 minute, 1 or 2 minutes for novices. So to schedule a time where it's just you and those two students together. And whatever the text is, that could be shared on screen. The students could be looking at it. That would be my suggestions. Do other people have other suggestions? So, okay. Oh, this is a great question I should have mentioned that I happened to see. How do you compensate for different time levels? And I forgot to mention that. Don't ever wait for everyone to be done. That's how you compensate. It's never, finishing the task is never the important part. And that's something I really have to make super clear to the students who would rather cheat and look at their partner's paper than have a wrong answer. And I have to look at them and say, I am going to throw this paper in the recycling bin the minute you walk out of the door, okay? You are not assessing whether or not they found the correct match, or they, you are assessing how they negotiated using the language. So the assessment is what you write down or provide feedback on as you're walking around the room. So finishing is totally unimportant, and you don't. Now I usually would try to have an early finishers folder in the front of my room, but once two or three pairs were done with an activity, it's over and then we're done.
I know you had that 20 word summary.
Yes.
Is there any like reason why it's 20 that you chose?
I don't think so. I really got that from another workshop. So yeah, I think you could make it any number. I appreciated the negotiation would incur if you did make it be exactly 20, because that would make it probably really hard. So I think it'd be totally up to you if you wanted to insist on that, or say no more than 20, or say if you want 25, add a couple more lines. I mean, I think the important thing is that later they're going to be, as far as interpersonal, is that later they're going to be having that conversation to come up with a new 20 words.
Yes. I just usually make limits on like how many new vocabulary they can look up, because they end up spending so much time.
Right.
And that's not necessary. Like, you're missing the point.
Right. And I think that's the thing, is I might say no dictionaries because it's based on a text they just read. I might insist you're going to have to use words that you already know or words that were in the text. So yeah. And to give a time limit, I think is great. God, as I kind of try to look through here, does anybody else have anything they can shout out? Is a comment?
I
question.
Hi there, Lisa. Regarding your intermediate students, you said, and the interpersonal role play tasks,
yes,
you would assess. You mentioned you would give them their role ahead of time. You talking about the day before or?
Okay, so I wouldn't give them the exact role. I would give them a task, but I would not tell them which of the two roles they were going to play until they got to my desk. We would probably be doing some practice ahead of time, and they would practice both roles, but they wouldn't know which one they were going to be. But the task itself, I would probably, you know, I tried at the beginning of a unit, give a document, because I didn't use a textbook. I would give a document with the can-do statements for the unit, and, you know, vocabulary that might be helpful to them, structures that might be helpful to them. And right on there, I would do a description of the IPA. So I would give them, you're going to read an infographic about sports. You're going to talk to your partner about what sports you play, and you're going to write a note to your key pal about your favorite sports. So they would have that much information in advance. Anybody else?
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
I'm starting a new book with my level threes this year.
Uh-huh.
That I've never taught before. And in the past, like Le Petit Prince and other, Un Papillon dans la Cité and other readers, uh-huh, I've had more of like the traditional defining some vocabulary for them, asking comprehension questions, and then we do other more discussions and things like that in class. But I'm rethinking how I teach a longer text, uh-huh, and I'm wondering, if you do like more having students write journals and like develop the questions on their own kind of thing, or how you approach longer readings.
Okay, so I would just send you, I mean, the best example that I could say is a few years ago on my blog, which it's just at madameshepherd.com if you're not familiar. It's called Madame's Musings, if that's easier to remember. If you have trouble spelling Shepherd, it's S-H-E-P-A-R-D. If you do a search on Petit Prince, I do have like a workbook. I see a smile, Holly. I don't know you. I'm not sure if that means if you've seen this document. But I do have a really long document about the Petit Prince, where I do have some ideas about how I did go about approaching that text. But there were a lot of kind of in this amount of time, because I don't want to move into the next group's time. I'll send you there for now, but I would be happy to answer any questions or talk about that more if you want to contact me at all. By my Gmail, it was on the beginning, and I will be sharing this, but it's Lisa Shepherd WLC, that's for a world language consultant, at Gmail. So Lisa Shepherd WLC at gmail.com.
Okay. Yeah, I've seen your website. I haven't seen that particular one for the Petit Prince.
It's from a few years ago, but yeah, if you do the search box, then okay. I think you'll find it.
Okay, yeah, just because I'm doing a new text, L'École Perdue, and I don't know any other teachers who've taught it, and so I'm just thinking, oh, maybe I'll try something different this time, and I'm just looking for new ideas.
Yeah, maybe that would jog your memory or jog your ideas looking over at that.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Any other question before Jane kicks me off here?
I have a question.
Sure.
This is Shelly. Hi.
Hi, Shelly.
My question is, when you're working with like novice to intermediate students, how do you prepare them for the task of you are going to create the question yourself? Because what I find is even with my level twos, they get in there and like, they're still a little bit, like they're just not super clear on it, or they're like at different levels about properly asking a question that is comprehensible to other people. And I'm sure other people have that situation as well.
Of course. Questions are hard. And I think that's why we put them at intermediate level. So I just really kind of like gradual release model, where in the beginning, I'm giving them the exact questions. And then we go to just like some starters and kind of gradually release. And also with the understanding their questions won't be perfect, but they will perfect them as their partners are using those negotiation skills. So, you know, if they try to say what, you know, Casca, but they say pourquoi, and then their partner's like, you mean Casca, and whatever, however their partner's going, you mean what or why, or whatever it is, there's going to be some negotiation that's going to cause them to get better.
Okay.
And of course, you're circulating, like I said, most of those were formative tasks. You're circulating the whole time. Everybody's getting that individualized feedback from you the whole time. So I'm going to look forward to looking back at the other chats. If I didn't get to you, please make sure to follow up with me. I'm happy to chat with you. And thank you so much for coming today. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Lisa. This was fascinating, and I'm sure everybody was frantically taking notes because there were so many great ideas.
Yeah, well, I know we'll share this out, so hopefully people can look at it again.
Yeah. Great. All right.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Take care. Bye bye.
And now, maintenant, on va passer à Marie-Josée Duquette de la délégation du Québec à Boston, qui va nous parler du Québec et des ressources offertes par le gouvernement du Québec aux professeurs de français. Marie-Josée, vous voulez partager votre écran?
Oui, je vais partager mon écran.
Voilà, voilà, c'est arrivé.
Parfait, donc merci beaucoup pour l'invitation. Alors, je suis vraiment heureuse d'être parmi vous aujourd'hui. Je vais partager mon écran. Est-ce que vous, voyez? Ah, okay, d'accord. Et je vais aller. En fait, je vais tout de suite vous présenter une vidéo parce que le congrès devait avoir lieu à Québec, en fait, à Trois-Rivières. Donc, pour un peu vous mettre justement. Est-ce que vous voyez mon écran? Voyez-vous mon écran?
Oui, on le voit. Oui.
Parfait. Okay, d'accord. Alors, je vais vous montrer justement, c'est une vidéo qui est sur le Québec et j'aimerais ça que vous écoutiez bien les mots parce que le narrateur est David Goudreau et c'est un romancier assez exceptionnel qui vient du Québec et il a aussi un accent et c'est un slammer et également un poète. Donc, je vais vous présenter cette petite vidéo sur le Québec.
Dites bonjour à vos vacances de rêve et de réalité. Pour voyager, pour se retrouver, découvrir le Québec, redécouvrir les plus beaux points de votre coin, puis même d'un peu plus loin. Dites bonjour à des montagnes qui en imposent, de la faune et de la flore qui vous envoûtent, des festins dignes des rois puis des reines. Une vie de château à vivre demain ou demain. Des gratte-ciels qui vous chatouillent les idées de grandeur, des horizons qui vous font tourner la tête. Et bronzer sous les étoiles à toute heure pour célébrer la vie sous mille soleils d'ici. Venez donc dire bonjour au Québec.
Et voilà. Donc, c'est une petite vidéo. Et là, je vais vous présenter, en fait, juste un instant. Si je vous présente, je vais juste m'assurer. Oh! Je dois faire ça avant. OK, parfait. C'est la magie de la technologie. Donc, vous voyez toujours mon écran?
Oui.
OK, parfait. Alors, on a passé, justement, on a fait une petite... vous avez vu une petite vidéo du Québec. Alors, voici. Alors, le Québec. Ici, bon, c'est la carte du Québec.
Ça, on voit toujours la vidéo, l'écran YouTube.
Ah, pardon.
Présentation encore.
OK, désolée. C'est bien de me faire... OK, alors, et voici. Et voilà.
Voilà.
Oui, OK, voilà, parfait.
Ça y est.
Merci. Donc, ici, c'est la carte du Québec. Vous voyez que le Québec est quand même très grand. La France rentre trois fois dans le Québec. On a ici le fleuve Saint-Laurent. Le fleuve Saint-Laurent, c'est très important dans le paysage québécois. Jacques Cartier est arrivé, en fait, par le fleuve Saint-Laurent. Nous sommes 8 millions de population au Québec, mais 80% de la population habite près du fleuve Saint-Laurent. Deux grandes villes, Montréal, qu'on voit ici, qui est petit Montréal, et la ville de Québec. Donc, quand on fait des présentations dans les écoles, on dit on a la province du Québec et la capitale, c'est Québec. Donc, c'est facile à retenir. Et vous, entre Montréal et Québec, il y a Trois-Rivières. Donc, votre congrès devait avoir lieu à Trois-Rivières. C'est vraiment entre Québec et Montréal. Donc, comme je disais, deux grandes villes, Québec et Montréal. Montréal et la région, on est environ 4 millions de population. Donc, ça vous donne une idée que la moitié de la population se trouve près de la ville de Montréal. Je vais vous parler maintenant des délégations du Québec. Alors, nous avons ici une carte mondiale et il y a exactement 33 délégations à travers le monde. Okay? Nous en avons 6 aux États-Unis. Nous en avons également au Mexique. Nous en avons aussi, on a 3 délégations qui sont en Afrique de l'Ouest parce que c'est des pays qui sont francophones. Nous avons également des bureaux qui sont en Europe, dont évidemment un bureau assez important à Paris. Et nous avons également des bureaux qui sont en Asie. Donc, vous pouvez voir quand même qu'on a beaucoup de bureaux à l'étranger, donc des délégations du Québec. Notre mandat, vraiment, c'est de défendre et de représenter les intérêts du Québec dans la région, en plus de développer et d'appuyer les échanges économiques, politiques, académiques, culturels et institutionnels. Donc, je vous donne un exemple. Moi, je travaille pour le bureau de Boston. Le bureau de Boston couvre toute la Nouvelle-Angleterre, donc les 6 États qui se retrouvent en Nouvelle-Angleterre. Si, par exemple, il y a une compagnie qui désire développer son marché aux États-Unis, nous allons l'aider, en fait, pour dans son développement de marché et mettre ces compagnies-là en contact avec des gens de la Nouvelle-Angleterre. Notre mandat, c'est également l'éducation, donc c'est pour ça que je suis ici aujourd'hui. Vous allez voir plus loin que je vais expliquer les visites qu'on fait dans les écoles. La culture, je suis également responsable de la culture au bureau de Boston. Donc, si un artiste désire venir en Nouvelle-Angleterre, mon rôle à moi, ça va être de mettre cet artiste-là en contact avec des diffuseurs. Donc, il y a certains bureaux aussi qui ont l'immigration. S'il y a des étudiants, entre autres, qui veulent immigrer ou qui veulent travailler, qui veulent étudier au Québec, il y a quand même un bureau, il y a des bureaux qui s'occupent de l'immigration. Donc, en général, c'est vraiment, on fait vraiment, nous, le lien entre le Québec et la région où nous sommes. Donc, je vais parler plus des délégations du Québec aux États-Unis, puisqu'évidemment, vous êtes aux États-Unis. Nous avons 6 délégations et 2 bureaux. La délégation générale du Québec se trouve à New York, donc une très grande équipe. Il y a 30 personnes, dont une personne qui s'occupe de l'éducation qui s'appelle Annie Lee. Alors, c'est elle qui s'occupe de l'éducation au bureau de New York. Vous avez ici les États, OK? Donc, dépendamment de votre où vous êtes, les États ici dont le bureau de New York couvre. Évidemment, il y a une délégation du Québec à Boston. La déléguée est Mme Marie-Claude Francoeur. Et nous sommes 8 personnes, donc nous sommes une petite équipe. Et comme je le disais, on couvre la Nouvelle-Angleterre, donc les 6 États de la Nouvelle-Angleterre. Le bureau est ouvert depuis 1970. Nous avons également une délégation du Québec à Atlanta, une petite équipe toujours, 6 personnes. Ici, vous avez encore les États, justement, qui couvrent cette délégation. Nous avons également une délégation du Québec à Chicago. une plus grande équipe, 11 personnes. J'ai eu la chance de faire un Zoom meeting pour trois écoles, avec la personne qui est responsable à Chicago, Martin Dionne. Donc, Martin Dionne s'occupe justement de l'éducation pour la délégation du Québec à Chicago. Encore une fois, vous avez ici les États. Et nous avons une très grande équipe à Los Angeles, donc la délégation du Québec à Los Angeles. Il y a 14 personnes qui travaillent à la délégation. Et nous avons également deux bureaux, donc à Houston et à Washington. C'est des petits bureaux qui sont présents. Donc, vous voyez bien qu'on couvre très bien, en fait, les États-Unis comme délégation. Maintenant, je vais vous parler des offres et des programmes, des services que nous offrons. Et je commence par des bourses universitaires. Il y a le Québec, en fait, a décidé de... Je vais juste mettre... OK. Le Québec, donc c'est un programme qui se veut un moyen de soutenir aux États-Unis les activités universitaires sur le Québec, de stimuler la collaboration interuniversitaire entre le Québec et les États-Unis, de soutenir l'organisation d'activités universitaires ayant pour thématique le Québec. Donc, dans ce programme-là, qui est offert aux universités, c'est important que ce soit un professeur qui est à temps plein dans l'université, à l'université. Et il y a deux volets. Je ne rentrerai pas trop dans les détails, mais je vais quand même vous parler de cette bourse-là parce que c'est des montants qui sont importants. Ça va entre 6 000 et 12 000 $ par année. Donc, il y a vraiment deux volets. Il y a un volet 1 qui est la recherche, innovation et développement du savoir. Il y a le volet 2, culture et langue française. Donc, ce qui est important, en fait, c'est que dans chaque volet, donc volet 1 et volet 2, il y a des catégories de projets. Donc, vous avez quatre catégories de projets. Et c'est les mêmes catégories de projets qui se retrouvent dans le volet 1 et dans le volet 2. Qu'est-ce qui change? C'est les thématiques. Donc, les thématiques vont être différentes d'un volet 1 au volet 2. Donc, si je parle ici des catégories, on a aide aux conférences et accueil de conférenciers. Donc, par exemple, si une université qui veut développer et organiser des conférences et avoir un chercheur, un professeur du Québec qui vient, il y a des bourses qui existent pour ça. Évidemment, les conférences vont aller selon les thématiques ciblées ici que vous avez. Donc, ce qui est important, c'est que la bourse est vraiment pour les frais de déplacement. Okay? Donc, ce n'est pas un salaire qui est donné, mais c'est vraiment pour des frais de déplacement ou pour la production, justement, de livres, de publications, etc. Okay? On a également, dans la catégorie de projet, soutien à l'élaboration de cours sur le Québec. Donc, il y a des bourses qui sont données justement pour des professeurs à l'université qui veulent créer des cours sur le Québec. On a également des bourses pour les professeurs et chercheurs. Donc, c'est vraiment des gens qui vont faire des recherches spécifiques sur le Québec. Et ensuite, soutien aux initiatives sur le Québec. Ici, on parle vraiment d'immenses projets, donc de créer, entre autres, un programme. Donc, vous avez ici les thématiques qui sont ciblées, n'est-ce pas? Et si je vais à la prochaine diapositive, qui est le volet 2, culture et langue française, je dois vous dire que nous, en Angleterre, on a beaucoup plus de demandes pour le volet 2, qui est culture et langue française. Donc, dans les thématiques ciblées, on a politique culturelle et identité québécoise, francophonie au Québec et aux États-Unis, la question liée à l'immigration, art et littérature québécoise, droit et liberté de la personne. Donc, c'est vraiment, comme je disais, c'est des bourses qui sont données aux universités américaine. Et vous pouvez d'ailleurs trouver toutes ces informations-là si vous allez sur le site Internet de la délégation du Québec à Boston. Vous allez voir justement un petit bandeau avec employés, programmes, etc. Et vous allez voir justement programme de bourse. Et vous pouvez cliquer sur le lien et vous allez pouvoir avoir plus d'informations là-dessus. Donc ça, c'est un programme que le gouvernement du Québec offre. Maintenant, on va aller plus dans ce que les délégations font. Donc, on fait beaucoup de visites dans les écoles, évidemment pour les étudiants qui apprennent le français, c'est souvent dans les high school et aussi les collèges. En général, c'est une présentation PowerPoint qui dure environ 40 minutes. Et ça, c'est les sujets qui sont abordés durant la présentation qu'on fait aux étudiants. Donc, on fait vraiment un survol sur le Québec, on va parler de la géographie, l'histoire, la population du Québec. On va également parler de notre travail parce que parmi les étudiants que vous avez, il y a probablement peut-être des gens qui sont intéressés pour travailler dans la diplomatie, donc faire des études plus à l'international. Donc, on va parler quand même de notre travail. On va également parler de la francophonie à travers le monde et aux États-Unis. Donc, puisque la délégation, entre autres, du Québec à Boston couvre la Nouvelle-Angleterre, comme vous le savez, on a un héritage francophone très important de Nouvelle-Angleterre. Donc, c'est intéressant de parler de l'histoire de ces Canadiens français qui ont traversé la frontière pour venir travailler en Nouvelle-Angleterre. On va également parler des possibilités d'étudier au Québec, puisque les étudiants apprennent le français. Donc, c'est peut-être quelque chose qu'ils aimeraient faire éventuellement, c'est-à-dire d'aller étudier au Québec. Et on aime beaucoup, en fait, terminer la présentation. Et moi, je pose souvent cette question-là aux étudiants. Pourquoi vous avez décidé d'apprendre le français comme langue seconde et non d'apprendre une autre langue? Et c'est toujours agréable d'entendre les réponses. Évidemment, toutes les réponses sont bonnes. Donc, c'est quelque chose qu'on aime bien savoir. Donc, pourquoi les étudiants ont décidé d'apprendre le français? Donc, cette présentation-là, comme je dis, dure 40 minutes. Souvent, la façon qu'on fonctionne, c'est si un professeur veut justement avoir cette présentation-là et qu'il s'agit de la première fois, on parle évidemment avec le professeur pour connaître les besoins et on peut ajuster la présentation selon les besoins justement de la classe. Je dois vous dire que durant la pandémie, on a fait énormément de Zoom rencontres avec les étudiants et les professeurs. Et ici, je prends une pause pour féliciter en fait tous les professeurs parce que ça n'a pas été une période facile, n'est-ce pas, cette pandémie-là. Et moi, j'ai quand même une fille de 15 ans qui va à l'école et je peux voir justement à quel point les professeurs ont dû se retourner assez vite pour pouvoir justement donner des classes et de stimuler, motiver les étudiants. Donc, vraiment, bravo. Et ça, je le tiens vraiment à le mentionner parce que donc, ça a été une période pas facile. Donc, et voilà, je tenais à le dire. Donc, c'est ça. On a fait beaucoup de Zoom meetings. Et puis, comme il y avait plusieurs territoires aux États-Unis, alors parfois, je le faisais aussi en collaboration avec d'autres délégations du Québec aux États-Unis. Ici, j'ai indiqué présentation sur les avantages d'apprendre le français comme langue seconde. Donc, ça a été une demande qui a été faite il y a environ, avant la pandémie. C'était un professeur qui était au middle school et ses étudiants, en fait, devaient apprendre le français 20 heures espagnol et 20 heures latin. Et ensuite, les étudiants choisissent la langue qu'ils veulent apprendre l'année suivante. Et j'étais invitée justement pour faire une présentation aux étudiants au middle school et de leur expliquer les avantages d'apprendre le français comme langue seconde. Donc, ce qu'on a fait à la délégation du Québec à Boston, on a une équipe de 8 personnes et il y a un jeune homme, en fait, dans la vingtaine, Michael, qui est vraiment extraordinaire, qui est américain, qui parle français. Et moi, je lui ai posé des questions en anglais. Et je lui ai posé la question, mais pourquoi évidemment avoir choisi le français quand tu étais justement étudiant au high school? Donc, c'est une vidéo qui dure environ 2 minutes et je trouve ça intéressant parce que les étudiants à ce moment-là peuvent plus se voir en Michael, ils peuvent plus s'identifier à Michael qu'à moi, bien sûr. Donc, on a fait cette vidéo-là et ça a été présenté justement à tous les étudiants du middle school. Et j'espère évidemment que ça a fonctionné, que ça a aidé pour ce professeur-là. Donc, ça a été une demande qui a été faite vraiment. Puis évidemment qu'on a accepté. Puis nous sommes allés dans cette école-là et présenté justement la vidéo. Donc, On a également des présentations spécifiques, c'est sur les études au Québec. Donc, il y a des écoles parfois qui nous demandent de faire une présentation aux étudiants et aux parents, parce qu'on le sait très bien que les parents sont très impliqués dans le processus décisionnel, au choix justement du collège, de l'université. Donc, il existe vraiment une présentation PowerPoint pour ces parents-là et les étudiants. Vous savez, au Québec, on a 14 établissements universitaires. Il y en a 3 qui sont anglophones et le reste est francophone. Donc, évidemment, on pense beaucoup à McGill University à Montréal, mais il y a également d'autres universités au Québec. Juste à Montréal, on a 2 universités, donc 2 universités anglophones et 2 universités francophones. Mais on a également la ville de Québec et des universités, mais aussi la région du Québec a des universités. Donc, c'est vraiment intéressant de pouvoir présenter justement aux parents. Et il existe ici une trousse d'informations sur l'offre éducative du Québec. Et ici, vous avez le lien. Donc, si vous êtes intéressé, entre autres, je vous conseille fortement de regarder ce lien-là parce que c'est un peu comme une Bible, là. Vraiment, on a toutes les informations qu'on a besoin dans cette trousse d'informations. Donc, quand on fait évidemment la présentation aux parents et aux étudiants, on va offrir cette trousse d'informations-là. Et parfois aussi, on participe avec le consulat canadien. On va participer au Canadian College Fair. En général, c'est donné en septembre. Je ne suis pas certaine pour cette année, et c'est donné à Portland dans le Maine et à Newton dans le Mass. Le Canadian College Fair, évidemment, il y a des universités qui viennent. En général, il y a entre 4 et 5 universités du Québec qui sont là et qui peuvent évidemment répondre aux parents et aux étudiants qui sont là. Donc, on est vraiment très actifs au niveau pour faire des présentations sur les études au Québec. Ensuite, il y a d'autres, ici, on a mis ces informations-là juste pour vous donner un peu une idée de notre rôle qu'on joue, de notre mission, notre mandat. Donc, c'est aussi appuyer les programmes de français. Donc, c'est déjà arrivé dans le passé, malheureusement, on a su qu'il y a un programme de français qui devait être aboli. Donc, on nous a contactés, on nous a demandé si c'était possible d'écrire une lettre. Et en collaboration avec le consulat français, le consulat canadien et évidemment la déléguée de notre bureau, il y a une lettre qui a été écrite et on parle vraiment, on donne des arguments pourquoi c'est important de maintenir le programme de français et cette lettre-là a été envoyée au superintendant. Donc, c'est un exemple que je vais vous montrer ici, donc comme pourquoi qu'on est ici, qu'est-ce qu'on peut faire pour vous. Participer à des activités dans le cadre du mois de la francophonie. Et on a indiqué le mois de la francophonie, donc le 20 mars est le jour de la francophonie en Nouvelle-Angleterre. On fait beaucoup, justement, ça dure presque un mois, c'est tout le mois de mars. Et il y a beaucoup d'activités qui sont présentes justement durant le mois. Et on a des spectacles, encore une fois, des spectacles en collaboration avec le consulat français. Parfois, on est invité pour remettre un prix, surtout quand il y a des dictées. Donc, il y a beaucoup d'activités. On est présent, on est souvent sollicité et on participe et on collabore justement. Et pour terminer, j'aimerais ça parler des activités qui sont faites en collaboration avec le Centre de la francophonie des Amériques. En 2019, il y avait une activité quand même assez importante qui s'appelait « Slam tes accents ». Mathieu Lippé était le porte-parole à ce moment-là de cette activité-là « Slam tes accents ». Mathieu Lippé est un slammer, puis il a gagné aussi plusieurs prix. Et il allait d'une école à l'autre pour aider les étudiants à créer un slam. Okay? Donc, et moi, je l'ai accompagné. J'ai accompagné Mathieu Lippé, c'était en Nouvelle-Angleterre à ce moment-là, qui allait d'une école à l'autre. Et vraiment, ça a été une activité extraordinaire. C'est Mathieu Lippé connecte très bien avec les étudiants. Les étudiants l'ont beaucoup aimé. Donc, les étudiants ont créé un slam et une vidéo. Cette vidéo devait être envoyée au Centre de la francophonie des Amériques. Il y avait un jury et le jury sélectionnait les meilleures vidéos et un prix qui était donné. Donc, et ça s'est fait durant le mois de la francophonie. Donc, il y a plusieurs écoles qui ont participé justement et qui ont accueilli Mathieu Lippé, pardon. Le concours Slam tes accents a également eu lieu au mois de mars, mais évidemment, il n'y a pas eu de visite d'un slameur dans les écoles. Et ça m'amène à vous parler justement du Centre de la francophonie des Amériques. C'est, pour ceux qui ne connaissent pas, c'est vraiment un petit bijou qui a beaucoup justement de ressources. Donc, ça a été inauguré le 17 octobre 2008 par le premier ministre du Québec et le président français. Donc, c'est vraiment, on a voulu ici créer un organisme qui joue le rôle de leader en francophonie et qui tisse des liens justement entre les communautés francophones. Et si vous allez sur leur site Internet, vous allez voir justement qu'il y a beaucoup de programmes, de services, d'outils qui sont donnés. Et vous voyez même un onglet où c'est marqué « enseignant ». Et si vous cliquez sur « enseignant », vous allez voir justement qu'il y a beaucoup de services qui sont offerts justement. Donc, c'est vraiment intéressant. Et là, je vais vous parler justement d'un outil qui est vraiment fort apprécié de tout le monde et particulièrement des professeurs, c'est la bibliothèque la bibliothèque des Amériques. Donc, c'est parrainé par Dany Laferrière, qui est membre de l'Académie française. On est très fiers de ça. Et c'est un service de prêt numérique, n'est-ce pas? Donc, c'est des livres numériques qui sont disponibles sur le téléphone intelligent, tablette, et ordinateur. La beauté de tout ça, c'est que c'est gratuit. Okay? Donc, pour pouvoir emprunter un livre numérique, il faut être membre du Centre de la francophonie, le Centre. Et pour être membre, ça ne coûte absolument rien. Donc, vous allez sur le site, vous devenez membre. Encore une fois, il n'y a aucun frais. Et vous pouvez, à ce moment-là, emprunter des livres à la bibliothèque. Ce qui est bien, c'est que quand vous êtes membre, vous pouvez également recevoir beaucoup d'informations sur les programmes et services. Et les professeurs de français en Amérique utilisent beaucoup la Bibliothèque des Amériques. Donc, je vous donne des chiffres clés ici. On parle de 14 000 livres, de 200 maisons d'édition. Il y a plusieurs prêts, vous voyez, 101 000 prêts et tout est en français. Donc, il y a beaucoup, le choix est immense dans les livres qu'on peut emprunter, mais aussi ce qui est bien, c'est qu'il y a des rendez-vous littéraires. Donc, si en tant que professeur, vous recommandez justement un livre aux étudiants, l'étudiant choisit le livre et les étudiants peuvent ensuite rencontrer l'auteur avec le rendez-vous littéraire. Et on sait à quel point, justement, une rencontre avec un auteur, ça peut être extraordinaire pour un étudiant, surtout quand on aime, évidemment, le livre, mais je veux dire, les rencontres littéraires entre les étudiants et l'auteur, c'est vraiment un moment magique, je pourrais dire. Et d'ailleurs, la dernière qui a eu lieu, c'est avec l'auteur Kim Tsui, qui a écrit le livre Rue, qui est évidemment un auteur extraordinaire, très charismatique, très, très gentil, chaleureuse, et aussi avec Marc Baudet. Mais il y a une rencontre littéraire qui a eu lieu entre Kim Tsui et des étudiants. Donc ça, c'est vraiment un service qui est donné, qui est gratuit. Et ce n'est pas tous les professeurs qui sont au courant, justement, de ce service-là. Et puis, comme je vous dis, c'est facile. Vous pouvez aller sur le site Internet du Centre de la francophonie des Amériques et vous pouvez, justement, voir tout ça. Il y a une personne qui est Alexandra, qui peut donner une présentation justement sur la bibliothèque, parce qu'il y a quand même une procédure là à suivre qui n'est vraiment pas compliquée, mais si vous, vous pouvez la contacter, je peux également vous donner son adresse courriel, ou vous pouvez m'écrire si vous désirez, je pourrais vous mettre en communication avec elle, et elle peut faire vraiment une présentation au professeur. Alors, comment ça fonctionne la bibliothèque numérique? Donc, j'ai parlé quand même assez vite. Excusez-moi, je vais arrêter. Stop to share. Stop. OK, parfait. Donc, j'aimerais ça savoir. OK, je vois qu'il y a des questions. Si vous. C'est pas évident quand il y a beaucoup de questions comme ça. Donc, ouais, la Bibliothèque des Amériques, merci beaucoup pour mettre le lien. Oui, la Bibliothèque des Amériques, c'est gratuit aussi. Bon, évidemment, concernant les passeports, bon, c'est sûr que là, actuellement, avec la pandémie, c'est autre chose. Mais bon, une fois qu'évidemment tout ça va être passé, puis on l'espère, ça va être différent. Oui, est-ce que vous avez des questions spécifiques? Oui.
Je veux dire, le problème, c'est que les élèves qui vont français qui sont aux États-Unis et qui vont à l'université, qui ont déjà été acceptés, ne peuvent pas arriver, commencer au 1er septembre s'ils n'ont pas leur passeport. Donc, je ne sais pas à qui m'adresser, donc j'ai sauté sur l'occasion que vous soyez là. Je ne savais pas que vous en occupiez également pour vous poser cette question, parce que je pourrais vous écrire en catimini et voir exactement où en est cette situation.
Oui, regardez, je vais vous mettre en fait dans le groupe chat ici, je vais indiquer. Attendez, comment est-ce que je peux faire donc tout? Parce que mon adresse courriel, en fait, c'est Marie-Josée Duquette, donc marie-josée.duquette, à commercial, et c'est le MRI pour le ministère de Relations internationales, donc mri.gouv au gouvernement. .ca pour Canada et .qc pour Québec. OK, alors c'est vraiment marie-josée.duquette. Donc, et on pourra également regarder ça. On fait souvent, on est beaucoup en collaboration également avec le consulat du Canada à Boston.
OK? Super. Merci.
Et voilà. Mais comme je disais, pour en fait les présentations qu'on fait dans les écoles, on ne sait pas trop qu'est-ce qui va se passer en septembre, mais par Zoom, on fait des présentations, justement. Okay? Donc, ça, je tenais beaucoup à le mentionner parce que c'est une activité qui peut être aussi assez intéressante pour les étudiants. Souvent, les professeurs, d'ailleurs, il y en a qui m'ont demandé de faire une petite recherche aux étudiants avant la présentation et de préparer des questions. Donc, évidemment... et après ça, les étudiants peuvent poser des questions.
La question, quelqu'un a posé une question sur la bibliothèque.
Oui.
Comment ça marche pour l'accès pour toute une classe à un livre? Est-ce que la classe peut emprunter?
Oui. Oui, la classe peut faire. Oui, la classe, c'est possible pour ça. Mais comme je vous disais, la personne ici, je vais écrire son nom, vous pourriez. OK. OK, parfait. Je vais vous écrire, en fait, le nom dans le groupe chat, de l'adresse courriel de la personne. Et cette personne-là, elle le sait que je fais une présentation, justement, OK, sur la bibliothèque. Donc, elle va pouvoir répondre facilement. OK. OK, regardez, attends, je vais juste vérifier parce qu'évidemment, si je vous donne la mauvaise adresse, ça va les mains. Donc, francophoniedesamériquesensemble.com. Alors, voici, ça, c'est son nom, en fait, de la personne vraiment qui s'occupe de la bibliothèque numérique. Et comme je vous le disais, vous pouvez lui écrire, mettez mon nom en référence. Elle le sait que je faisais une présentation sommaire sur la bibliothèque. Est-ce que vous voyez? Ah, c'est marqué privé. Je viens de le répondre à... Attendez. Je ne vais pas le mettre privé. Excusez-moi encore. La technologie. Okay. Donc, je veux à tout le monde. Everyone. Here we go. OK? Vous l'avez?
Oui.
OK, parfait. Merveilleux. Merci.
Parfait.
OK.
Est-ce que une autre, quelqu'un a posé la question si la bibliothèque est ouverte à des gens partout dans le monde?
Non, c'est seulement en Amérique.
En Amérique, seulement en Amérique.
Oui. C'est vraiment, c'est la francophonie des Amériques, donc c'est seulement, oui.
D'accord. Est-ce qu'il y a d'autres questions? On aurait beaucoup aimé être à Trois-Rivières aujourd'hui.
Non, écoutez, je comprends, là, oui. C'est assez particulier. Oui?
Oui, donc moi, j'aurais une question. Vous avez mentionné qu'il y avait une antenne dans la Silicon Valley, mais ensuite, vous ne l'avez pas rementionné dans la liste de vos
différents... Oui, non, tout à fait, mais si... D'accord. Donc, si vous voulez avoir une présentation, exemple, sur le Québec, OK... Moi, j'irai avec la délégation du Québec à Los Angeles. Tandis que Silicon Valley, c'est beaucoup plus pour la technologie. Alors, concernant l'éducation, ce que je vous conseille, c'est d'aller sur le site Internet de la délégation du Québec à Los Angeles et vous allez voir justement, surtout dans affaires publiques, tout ce qui est éducation est dans affaires publiques. OK? Donc, tandis que Silicon Valley, c'est plus pour économie puis high-tech.
Bonjour, excusez-moi, j'aurais une question aussi.
Allez-y. Allez-y.
Oui, je voudrais savoir si nous pourrions avoir le lien de la vidéo du jeune homme qui explique pourquoi il a choisi le français.
Ah, ben oui,
il me semble qu'il s'appelle Matthew, je crois.
Non, Michael. Je pourrais...
Oh, Michael.
Oui, voilà. C'est ça. Il n'y a pas de problème, en fait. Est-ce que vous pouvez... D'ailleurs, regardez, je vais écrire mon adresse ici. Merci beaucoup. Envoyer une demande, puis je pourrais vous l'envoyer à ce moment-là. Je ne l'ai pas avec moi, bien sûr.
Je crois, si on pouvait le mettre dans le chat, ce serait bien parce que plusieurs personnes ont posé la même question.
Marie-Josée.Suquette.
J'ai une question.
Merci.
Oui. OK, j'aimerais savoir, vous avez parlé un peu de bourse, comment ça fonctionne?
Oui, c'est ça. Donc, la bourse, ça s'adresse à des universités aux États-Unis. Donc, le professeur, en fait, qui fait la demande doit être professeur à temps plein. Quand vous appliquez justement pour avoir une bourse, on conseille fortement de le faire entre 1 et 2 mois. Pour avoir une réponse, ça prend entre 1 et 2 mois. Si vous allez justement, je pourrais vous donner en fait le site, je vais vous mettre le lien juste un instant. OK. Et voilà. Excusez-moi, je fais beaucoup de choses en même temps. Okay. Donc, ici, vous avez plus en détail le lien. Et voilà, que je vais vous mettre ici. Si vous faites une demande, OK. Okay. Donc, vous avez ici beaucoup plus d'informations justement concernant la bourse. Si vous êtes intéressé, vous pouvez également, on peut se parler plus en détail, mais donc ça s'adresse vraiment à des professeurs d'université qui sont à temps plein. Et c'est souvent les frais, en fait, comme j'expliquais, les bourses, ça couvre beaucoup les frais de déplacement et aussi des frais de publication, des choses comme ça.
OK, merci.
Ouais. D'autres questions? Marie-Josée, j'ai une question. On a souvent des demandes pour mettre ensemble des classes aux États-Unis et dans les pays francophones pour les jumeler, en quelque sorte. Est-ce qu'il y a un système ou une façon de...
Oui, je sais, c'est une demande et ça se fait... Je sais, ça se fait beaucoup aussi avec la France. Donc, je sais qu'il y a des professeurs qui nous demandent également la même chose. Ce qu'on fait, c'est qu'on y va aussi de façon individuelle, c'est-à-dire que ça dépend également de la région. Et on y va de façon plus aussi personnelle, c'est-à-dire que moi, bon, je connais évidemment des professeurs ici au Québec, etc. Donc, on peut faire des demandes à ce moment-là. Donc, on y va vraiment de façon individuelle. Je sais qu'en Nouvelle-Angleterre, comme c'est près évidemment du Québec, il y a beaucoup aussi de voyage qui se fait. Donc, les professeurs emmènent les étudiants à la ville de Québec. Ça se fait beaucoup. Quand c'est une question plus de jumelage, c'est-à-dire vraiment d'un échange d'une école à l'autre, ce qu'on demande, c'est de nous envoyer des demandes à ce moment-là plus individuelles. Mais je sais que vous avez des demandes et on fait vraiment notre possible pour vous mettre justement en lien avec des écoles spécifiques. C'est ça. Parce que c'est bien les échanges, surtout... Surtout, bon, en septembre, encore une fois, on ne sait pas trop qu'est-ce qui va se passer. Est-ce que ça va être virtuel? Bon, l'avantage, je pourrais dire, s'il y a avantage dans cette pandémie, c'est qu'avec la technologie maintenant, on peut faire des conférences comme ça qu'avant, on ne faisait pas. Donc là, actuellement, je veux dire, s'il y a un jumelage qui est fait avec une autre école, ça pourrait être beaucoup plus facile pour échanger puis faire des... avec justement cette technologie. Je m'excuse pour le son. Oui, I would like to request a Zoom presentation. Pour Lisa, yes, I would say yes. Yes, you can go directly to the Atlanta office. If for any reason you don't have answer, just contact me and I will try to find you. Okay, so that's not a problem pour Lisa. C'est l'échange de professeurs de lycée. Est-ce qu'il y a des programmes d'échange de professeurs de lycée? Non, ça, par exemple, on n'a pas d'échange de professeurs de lycée. Mais, bon, il existait, là, on se comprend que la situation est particulière, mais il existe justement les universités souvent offrent durant l'été, bon, des cours justement, puis souvent il y a des professeurs qui se présentent à ces cours-là et qui deviennent en fait, qui élargissent leur contact, leur réseau avec les professeurs d'université. Mais moi, je connais des professeurs qui profitent de l'été pour aller passer une semaine ou deux à Québec justement et qui peuvent prendre des cours de français dans les universités. Mais il n'existe pas de programme d'échange de professeurs. OK, donc je vais remettre mon je vais juste mettre mon adresse encore une fois parce que OK. Parce que je vais vraiment vous remercier En fait, je suis vraiment contente d'être là, comme on dit, parce que les délégations, il y a beaucoup de délégations, comme vous avez pu voir à travers les États-Unis. Et on est vraiment là pour aider. En tout cas, ça me fait vraiment plaisir de faire cette présentation. Donc, c'est vraiment un survol de programmes et de services. Mais comme je vous dis, souvent, on va répondre à une demande précise. Okay, donc, ne vous gênez pas si vous avez justement une demande précise.
Oui, bonjour. Je voudrais savoir quelle est la différence entre le bureau de New York et le bureau de Washington, parce que la dernière ligne, c'était il y a aussi un bureau à Houston et un bureau à Washington. Oui.
Non, ben c'est ça. Non, si vous voulez avoir justement une formation, une visite, allez à ce moment-là beaucoup plus au bureau général à New York. La délégation, pardon, la délégation à New York. Les bureaux, c'est vraiment, c'est spécifique, ils n'ont pas des mandats d'éducation. Donc, tandis que la délégation générale à New York, si c'est sur votre territoire, moi, je vous conseille fortement d'aller à ce moment-là à ce bureau, à cette délégation. La personne qui s'occupe de l'éducation, c'est Annie Lee. Donc, A-N-N-I-E et le nom de famille L-E.
D'accord, merci.
D'autres questions? J'essaie de remonter dans le chat et je ne vois pas d'autres questions qu'on a manquées.
Oui, excusez-moi, moi j'en ai une autre.
Ok, allez-y.
Pour les demandes de bourse, est-ce qu'il faut s'adresser au bureau qui est le plus proche de notre ville? Parce que la ville où je suis, je ne l'ai pas vue, donc je ne sais pas
si... Ça dépend de l'État.
Ah. Enfin, oui, je n'ai pas vu l'État non plus dans la description de la distribution des bureaux. Je suis au Texas. Oui,
vous voyez... Ah, attendez, je vais regarder, je pense qu'à ce moment-là, ça serait-il juste... Pouvez-vous m'envoyer, je vais répondre, je vais faire une recherche, puis je vais vous envoyer la réponse en haute.
Parce que je suppose que si je suis intéressée par un programme de bourse, je ne pourrais pas m'adresser à Boston, par exemple. Si je suis
non, non, mais moi, ça m'arrive souvent que je reçois des demandes, et les demandes... attendez, mais je vais juste regarder. Et là, nous, ce qu'on fait à ce moment-là, on réfère la personne. Ça arrive quand même assez souvent. Attendez, je vais juste regarder ça ici. Écoutez, pouvez-vous m'en... Votre nom, c'est...
Nathalie Laborde.
OK.
Oui.
Pour le Texas, je vais vous revenir.
Bon, pas de souci, je vais vous envoyer un email et puis...
Merveilleux, OK.
Comme ça. Merci.
Bon. Oui, moi, j'aurais une autre question. Vous auriez une présentation type sur les universités au Québec? Parce que je vous avoue que ma fille a été à McGill. Bon, elle a gradué extraordinaire. Elle en est très contente. Et très souvent, quand les élèves me posent des questions, en fait, je lui donne les coordonnées de ma fille. Mais si vous aviez une présentation type, ce serait bien déjà de pouvoir la leur donner.
Oui. En fait, on a une présentation qui est une présentation PowerPoint, mais elle est très longue, cette présentation-là. Elle dure une heure et vraiment, on va vraiment dans les détails. Si vous désirez, je peux vous l'envoyer. Ça, il n'y a pas de problème. Mais c'est quand même une présentation qui est quand même très, très longue parce que ça s'adresse vraiment aux parents et aux étudiants et ça dure environ une heure. Donc, oui, il existe cette présentation-là qu'on peut vous faire parvenir. Ça, il n'y aura pas de problème. Mais encore une fois, ça va vraiment dans les détails. Sinon, moi, je recommande beaucoup la trousse d'informations pour étudier au Québec où vraiment cette trousse-là, en fait, renferme toutes les informations que vous avez besoin là, pour étudier au Québec.
D'accord. Merci.
Est-ce que le PowerPoint est disponible sur le site, la présentation du PowerPoint?
Oui. Oui, okay. Oui, je l'ai mis dans le dossier.
OK, parfait. Donc, parce que vous avez justement le lien à ce moment-là pour la trousse d'informations, si vous le désirez.
Oui. Il est là. Je viens de recevoir la présentation de Lisa que j'afficherai cet après-midi. Mais celle de Marie-Josée, je l'ai mise hier. Donc. Parfait. Ça y est? Il n'y a pas d'autres questions?
Je vais vous encore une fois rajouter mon adresse courriel parce que ça va vite dans les échanges.
Oui. Et ça, c'est dans la présentation aussi. C'est pas au début de la présentation du PowerPoint?
Non, je ne l'ai pas. je l'ai pas mis, donc c'est pour ça. Mais vous savez, encore une fois, si vous allez sur le site Internet du gouvernement, vous avez toutes les adresses courriel de tout le monde. C'est pas ça, Jésus?
OK. Bon, s'il n'y a pas d'autres questions, donc je remercie Marie-Josée de cette présentation et Lisa aussi de sa présentation auparavant. J'espère que vous avez beaucoup appris et on vous remercie de votre attention. Donc, à demain, j'espère. Demain, c'est le dernier webinaire.
Jen, j'ai une petite question pratique à vous poser. Quand on a assisté à tous les webinaires, est-ce que vous faites un certificat global ou est-ce que chaque webinaire, on est obligé de vous envoyer une photo?
Jusqu'à présent, on a fait chacun individuellement.
D'accord.
Si vous préférez en avoir un seul, on pourrait le créer. Mais...
Bon, c'est pour vous aider. Oui.
Le système, on l'a fait pour faire chacun.
OK, merci.
Merci.
Excuse me, Jane.
Oui.
So, since I wasn't able to take pictures, I take a screenshot of my phone to show the time I've been here?
It's not necessary. I've marked your name down, so we've got you.
Okay.
I know
you
were here.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. So, whoop. Sorry, we have a train. It's also in the office. Did you have a question, Gloria?
Yes, I do. This question is actually for Lisa Shepherd. I was wondering whether she uses French when she gives instructions to her students for all the activities that she talked about in her presentation. Can you hear me?
I think she has left.
Oh, so you can hear me. Jane, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Good. That was my question. Because her activity seemed to be rather difficult. So I was wondering what class, what level she teaches.
Instructions. Okay, I will send that question to her so that we get it in there.
The level of French that she teaches, the activities seem to be pretty difficult. I don't think they're there for novice students.
Well, I think like any exercise, you have to introduce them to the students. Once they know what the activity is, then I think it's much easier. But when you start with something that takes a little bit of preparation, but I will ask that question so that we add that her response to the chat shared with everyone.
Okay, thank you, Jane.
Okay. Okay. Bon, merci tout le monde et à demain, j'espère. Passez une bonne journée. Au revoir.
Au revoir.
Au revoir.